Welcome to Blood Part 2, Leukocytes and Platelets. Today's tutorial is the second part of my series on blood components. I'm Dr. Kathryn Moore, the Histology Wizard. This cartoon shows collected blood that's been prevented from clotting and separated into layers by centrifugation. And here you can see all of the components of blood, including plasma and erythrocytes, which I covered in part 1 of my blood videos. Today, I'll continue my discussion of blood, focusing on the components of the middle layer, called the buffy coat, which is about 1% of the total volume. And this layer contains the leukocytes, or white blood cells, which are the body's cheek defenses against infection, and platelets, which are critical for coagulation. We'll start with leukocytes. Leukocytes are generally spherical and inactive while suspended in circulating blood, but when they're called to sites of infection or inflammation, they can cross the walls of venules or capillaries, become amoeboid and motile, so that they can migrate into tissues and then display their defensive capabilities. Leukocytes are divided into two groups: granulocytes that possess two major types of cytoplasmic granules, lysosomes, which are also sometimes called xerophilic granules, and specific granules that bind neutral, acidic, or basic stains. Granulocytes also have polymorphic nuclei, and this just means they have two or more distinct nuclear lobes, but sometimes they almost look like separate nuclei. These cells are all terminally differentiated and live just a few days, and normally die of apoptosis. The second class, agranulocytes, don't have specific granules, but they can contain lysosomes. These cells also do not have lobe nuclei, but instead their nuclei are spherical or even indented. Each of these cells has specific functions, and I'll talk about each cell, what specific function it is, and how to recognize it in the blood. I'll start with the most abundant of the circulating leukocytes, the polymorphonuclear neutrophil. Usually it's just called a neutrophil, or sometimes a PMN for short. The PMN is a granulocyte, and as you may have guessed from its name, neutrophil, its granules are neutral in color, so none of them stain very well with the traditional blood stain, the right stain that you see here. Neutrophils make up about 50 to 60% of all the circulating leukocytes. They're short-lived, so they only live about 6 to 8 hours in the blood and only a couple of days in tissues. They're active against bacteria. They act as killing machines and phagocytes, and they are an arm of the innate immune system. They are easily the most recognizable white blood cell with their very characteristic highly lobed nucleus. Importantly, they're usually the first white blood cells to arrive at sites of infection, actively pursuing bacteria by chemotaxis. I think of these first responders as the EMTs of the body, and I'll talk about how they're dispatched and arrive at scenes of infection shortly. But first I want to talk about how these cells neutralize and kill bacteria. So let's look at an electron micrograph of a neutrophil. First, you see this lobed nucleus. Now, this cell has two lobes, but neutrophils can contain up to 5 lobes normally. The cells contain cytoplasmic granules, those xerophilic primary granules resembling lysosomes. These contain proteases and antibacterial proteins, including peroxidases, lysozymes, and defensins. They also contain smaller granules that contain enzymes that help degrade the extracellular matrix, and chemokines that help attract other white blood cells to the sites of infection or inflammation. But how do they actually kill bacteria? Well, we know that neutrophils engulf bacteria, internalizing them in vacuoles called phagosomes. Their granules will fuse with those phagosomes and discharge their contents, which kills the bacteria. And this is called the respiratory burst or oxidative burst. And this makes neutrophils microbial killing machines. Now, one of the most important enzymes in this process is NADPH oxidase. And interestingly, infants who have mutations in this oxidase are unusually susceptible to bacterial infections. Now, when you combine all of the functions of neutrophils that I just described, this really leaves behind a mess. Apoptotic neutrophils, dead bacteria, semi-digested material, whole bunch of tissue fluid. And this yellow viscous concoction is called pus. The leakage of killing factors and signaling molecules is called inflammation. And in inflammatory conditions, neutrophils will accumulate dark, coarse granules. So if you see these so-called toxic granulations, you'll know you're looking at activated neutrophils. So that's how neutrophils actually work. But to do their jobs, neutrophils, like all white blood cells, have to leave the microvasculature in injured or infected tissues. The EMTs have to go to the site of infection. So they do this through a process called extravasation or diapedesis. And I want to walk through this process using this cartoon and neutrophils as my example. So here you see a neutrophil inside a blood vessel. Endothelial cells of blood vessels contain selectins, and neutrophils and other white blood cells express selectin ligands, such as integrins, on their surfaces. Neutrophils in particular will normally bind loosely to these selectins, and they then roll along the blood vessels, lightly adhering. We call this population of neutrophils marginated, and marginated neutrophils are a key source of neutrophils. Like those EMTs, they can be rapidly deployed to the places that they're needed. So how does this happen? Well, signaling molecules called cytokines are released at sites of infection and inflammation, and these signal to endothelial cells, particularly at those junctions between the cells. This signaling then is going to upregulate selectins on endothelial cells and integrins on white blood cells, and this causes increased interactions between the neutrophils and the selectins. So if you think about the neutrophils rolling along the blood vessel like tennis balls that are rolling along a pipe, and wham, suddenly they get stuck on a patch of Velcro. Now these stuck neutrophils receive even more signals and they become activated. And then they start to extend pseudopodia and they're able to migrate out of the venules. So basically they squeeze between the endothelial cell junctions. And we call this process extravasation or diapedesis. Once they're out and into the tissue, the PMNs will migrate towards the source of the signals via chemotaxis. They're now fully functional and ready to perform their jobs in the tissue where they're needed. Now remember, all leukocytes have this ability. Now I'm going to quickly describe the other two classes of granulocytes. Next up is the eosinophil. Eosinophils are far less numerous than neutrophils. They're about the same size, but as you can see in this image here, they have a bilobed nucleus and large acidophilic granules that look pink or red. The classic function of the neutrophil is to kill parasitic worms or helminths, but we now recognize them as critical modulators of the inflammatory response in many tissues. More and more, our understanding of these cells is evolving. They seem to be involved in connective tissues underlying the epithelia of bronchi and the gastrointestinal tract, and their numbers are enormously upregulated in chronic asthma and eosinophilic esophagitis. So how do eosinophils function? Well, this EM shows the characteristic granules of the eosinophil that contain major basic protein. It's this that gives the cell its acidophilia and acts to kill larval parasites. Now, there's also evidence that it's the release of major basic protein that is so damaging to tissues in asthma and eosinophilic esophagitis. Moving on, our final granulocyte is the basophil. Now, this is the least common of the blood cells. It also has two lobes like the eosinophil, but they're very hard to see because of the dark bluish-purple large granules. Importantly, these cells, although they're related to mast cells, are not the same. Remember, mast cells are found in the tissues, but not in the blood. Now, basophils do function similar to mast cells. Their granules contain histamine and heparin, and they secrete IgE. Basophils are typically associated with seasonal allergies and are central to type 1 hypersensitivity reactions. If we have rapid excitosis of basophilic granules, this can result in asthma, hives, rhinitis, conjunctivitis, and extremely rapid degranulation leads to vasodilation in many organs. That can lead to a drop in blood pressure, and that's what we call anaphylactic shock. Basophils are also important signaling molecules. They call eosinophils to the site of inflammation and allergic reactions. So with the neutrophils, eosinophils, and basophils, that's it for the granulocytes. So let's take a quick look at the agranulocytes. First up is the monocyte. Now these large cells have a distinct, large, indented nucleus. It can even be C-shaped. Importantly, it's not lobed. The chromatin is lightly condensed, so it also stains lightly. The cytoplasm is basophilic and contains lysosomes. Now these cells, like neutrophils, can perform that oxidative or respiratory burst. What are monocytes? Monocytes are the precursors to macrophages. And that includes histiocytes, osteoclasts, Kupffer cells, and the liver. Now note that all monocyte-derived cells are antigen-presenting cells, so they all play a role in immune defense. The last agranulocyte is the lymphocyte. Lymphocytes are the most numerous agranulocytes and the second most numerous white blood cell. They're also typically the smallest. They have a spherical nucleus, and it's roughly the size of a red blood cell, and there is very little visible cytoplasm. Lymphocytes can be divided into functional groups by distinctive surface molecules. So these are our T cells and our B cells that play important roles in acquired immunity, as well as having some innate immune functions. Lymphocytes do have a wide size range. Most of them are quite small, but some of them are larger with even less visible cytoplasm. Now these may even contain a few granules. We call these natural killer cells, and they are a component of the innate immune system. Natural killer cells play a major role in host rejection of tumors and in killing virally infected cells. So that's it for the white blood cells. Now the last blood component I'd like to talk about is the platelet or the thrombocyte. Now platelets aren't actually cells, but they're very small, non-nucleated membrane cell fragments. They're sometimes called formed elements. Now they often look like specks in a blood smear, or even small clumps, but an individual platelet is sort of a discoid shape. Platelets lack nuclei, but they do have organelles. They originate from the ends of cytoplasmic processes of megakaryocytes, which I describe in my hematopoiesis video. So what exactly do platelets do? Well, platelets function in hemostasis, which really just means the stopping of the flow of blood. But it's important to note that this function is critical to maintaining the integrity of our closed cardiovascular system. So let's dig into hemostasis just a little bit. So this process essentially seals large blood vessel ruptures, and it occurs at the blood tissue surface. Importantly, many of the components that are critical to hemostasis are produced in the liver and circulate in the blood, and some are released from platelets. So I'm just going to briefly describe the steps. First, we see damage to a blood vessel, which will release clotting factors. Also, at the same time, the smooth muscle of the blood vessel will contract to prevent blood flow. Platelets will bind to collagen and they stick together, or agglutinate, and this forms a sticky plug. And the sticky plug alone can plug small holes or ruptures. The bound platelets can become activated and they promote blood clotting reactions. And this will give rise to a fibrin polymer that forms a 3D structure or network or matrix, and that will trap red blood cells, more platelets, and other cells. And this clot is now going to protect the underlying tissues so that they can then be restored and then the clot can be removed. Interestingly, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory agents, such as ibuprofen or aspirin, can inhibit coagulation. And that's because they block prostaglandins, and prostaglandins are needed to cause platelet aggregation or agglutination and contraction. There are also some rare genetic disorders that involve factors on platelet surfaces that are needed to bind collagen and to kickstart coagulation. And so mutations in these factors can result in abnormally slow clotting. Now, I'm not going to cover the entire clotting cascade today, but I just want to highlight a few important players. First of all, one of the most important steps in the cascade is the production of thrombin, an enzyme in blood plasma which causes the clotting of blood by converting fibrinogen to the fibrin monomer. And then those fibrin fibers form that weak but dense mesh that I just described. And that mesh will eventually cross-link and collect other cell types, platelets, red blood cells, white blood cells, and fibroblasts, to form the clot. Importantly though, because the production of thrombin is critical to initiate coagulation, prothrombin activator is the rate limiting step in this whole process. To conclude this tutorial, here I've summarized the key functions of the leukocytes and platelets. Be sure to check out my video Blood Part 1 if you want to learn more about erythrocytes. To learn about hematopoiesis, check out my hematopoiesis videos. Thanks for stopping by.